Let me ask you this question. When's your first attestation?
Look,
full manuscript of Sahih Bukhari.
I'm telling you this. Hang on, I'm telling you. Okay. Do you know how I attest Bukhari?
You can tell me
how
you
do. Do I rely on manuscripts?
First, answer the question.
Do I rely on manuscripts alone?
Listen, answer the question.
I'm telling you.
And then you can tell me.
I'm just telling you. I don't rely on manuscripts alone.
Okay, so when's your first Bukhari?
I'm just telling you. I don't rely on manuscripts alone.
It's a documentation of narrations that's in the book.
Yeah.
So it's not just one thing. It's many.
I don't rely on manuscripts alone.
So I'm saying this Bukhari wrote about 200 years.
I can find the source that he wrote written from.
So he wrote about 200 years after the life of Muhammad.
No, he didn't.
Okay, when did he write it? When did Bukhari write?
Look, Bukhari is a collection that he wrote. Wait, listen. What he wrote, I mean, of course, this is not contemporary to the Prophet of Islam. He got information. We know how he got his information. We can trace this information lineage by transmission of that information.
Yeah.
We have a chain of narration going back to the event, the narrator who's narrating it, an eyewitness event. Do you have that?
No,
if you don't have the manuscript,
you're missing the point. Let me clarify my point first.
We want to know, the discussion we're having is, you believe that you have evidence for Christ's crucifixion, now he's dead. I said, okay, what is the evidence? So far, you've given the belief of scholars, which is not an evidence.
No, I didn't.
You said the scholars believe. You told me the followers believe. That's not an evidence, because this is a belief of the followers.
Wait,
listen. This is an evidence of that the people believe that he was crucified, but it is not a belief that crucifixion happened. It's establishing historically there are people who believe that he died, but it doesn't mean actually he died.
So the question is,
just like
why?
Just like wait,
so
wait.
As people,
excuse
can
me,
can I finish my point?
Right. Yeah. Then you bring the evidence. Question about this. I asked you about. You said John was an eyewitness.
Sir.
So we went into another, you know, an avenue of attestation of evidence. And that evidence is testimonial evidence, testimony of John. So I wanted to ask you, I asked you clearly, to accept a witness to provide evidence, there's at least two conditions that we met.
Yeah.
I should have given many, I only give you two. One of them is the character integrity of the witness, and the other one is contemporaneity of the event that they witnessed. So the testimony the witness provide might be an eyewitness direct testimony, not a third hand witness evidence, because
direct.
It's not evidence.
Let me finish.
Do you have that? The answer is no, because all you provide is John Ryland's manuscripts, P52, doesn't talk about the crucifixion of Christ. The crucifixion part, even if it talks about it, is much, much later. So you don't have a contemporary material evidence which talks about the crucifixion, which you believe is written by John.
He is what?
Not only that, he's what?
He's a historian, he's a Jewish historian, Flavius Josephus, who wrote a history of Judaism in 93.
And what what do we know about Joseph Flavius in terms of when he's writing about this text? Is he embellishing it?
Well, he's saying that Jesus actually died.
No. Did he embellish what he wrote?
Obviously,
you haven't read about the scholarship issue. I'm not appealing to scholarship, but the actual. No. Hear me out. If you read about the account of Josephus, you'd know Josephus has embellished the account.
Okay, so what's the evidence?
The evidence is on the very text itself.
Tell me the evidence.
No, repeat the evidence. I'm going to tell you one thing.
Okay, go.
I'm going to spoon feed you all the evidence. I would want you to go and learn about this evidence. So far, I've been keeping spoon feeding you all the time. I'm sorry, I'm getting bored of spoon feeding. So the point I'm making,
William, made the basis.
Let me come back to this point.
Scholars,
so now,
evidence.
I'm just telling
you. What's your evidence about Josephus?
I'm just telling you, this is a common knowledge about the writings of Josephus on this issue, right? So I don't need to quote a single scholar. If you didn't know about it, you can go and learn about it, right? I'm not going to spoon feed you as I said.
Give me your evidence.
Right. So as I said, this is something that you can establish yourself by a little bit of reading. The point I'm making here is, the witness that you bring, if you don't have a contemporary evidence in terms of a written manuscript, at least provide.
Let me finish, William. You're deviating.
No, let me finish. Remember what I asked for. A witness has to be someone who provides contemporary testimony.
Well, but he just bought Josephus and you've just rejected it. And I'm saying, give me your evidence.
Was Josephus an eyewitness?
No, he wasn't, but his father
Khalas, would have been. Dismissed.
No, not at all. Do you know who his father was?
Listen.
You know, who
am I asking for an eyewitness testimony? What am I asking for?
Who was Josephus' father?
I have no idea.
He was a priest.
And?
So what is it? If he was a priest, where does that put him at the time when Jesus was crucified?
So if your dad tells you everything, everything is
I'm
true.
I'm just saying that it corroborates what Jesus
said. So basically, if we have a father telling his son, the father...
His father would have been there when Jesus was crucified.
Let me finish.
So when Josephus is making it...
William, if you have a father narrating to his son, you're saying everything the father narrates, you take it as a gospel truth.
I'm saying it's evidence.
In any culture.
No, I'm saying it's
in any situation.
It's evidence. Listen.
No, it's not an evidence. I'm telling why. The evidence would be understanding the character of the father. Is the father a possessor of character integrity? Was he honest? Was he truthful? Did he have a good memory? So let's go back again. Do you have the John that you're bringing as an evidence, as a testimonial evidence, as a witness? Do you find, instead of having the lack of any manuscript evidence, okay, let's put it aside because you haven't got anything. Do you have a continuous chain of transmission from people narrating from person to person who are honest and sincere, good memory, no reason to doubt their testimony? Do you have that?
We don't need a chain.
No, I'm asking you.
If you don't have that link, then you have no evidence.
We don't need a chain because we've got the writings of Peter.
So what's the evidence?
Let me finish.
Yeah.
Was Peter an eyewitness?
Of course Peter was an eyewitness. Yeah, he went to the tomb. He was
and he saw Christ die.
No, he didn't see Christ die.
Then John, he wasn't an eyewitness.
No, but John saw...
Dismissed.
Okay, so John saw him die. John saw him die.
John.
Yes.
That's what we were analyzed so far.
Yeah.
John, even if he was an eyewitness, who testified? Who testified that John was a truthful person?
Another historian.
Can you now establish the character integrity of John?
The reason why I said this is a waste of time.
Now,
let me explain.
So in a court of law, you bring a witness and you can't provide whether this guy is an honest person or not. And you can accept his testimony?
This is the question I ask.
There's so many...
I need to know his epistemology.
I just told you my epistemology. I am happy with accepting evidence in any court of law.
Let me finish.
So I asked him, what historical event in antiquity does he accept to be an historical event?
I just told you. Any court of law, I am being so flexible and so lowering my standard. I am saying, in any court of law, what a sane, reasonable judge would accept as evidence, I would accept that.
I'm talking about you.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay, so in antiquity...
So tell me now, what evidence can you take to any court of law in which a reasonable, sane judge would accept as evidence?
Mansour, I'm talking to you.
I just told you.
No, you're trying to...
He's failed again and again to provide a single piece of evidence that Christ was dead, and that is the core of your belief.
Listen.
Can you believe that? A core of your belief is Christ crucified, and you can't provide a single evidence.
Plenty, but listen.
There's a broken chain there.
There's not a broken chain.
Such a core belief, and you can't substantiate with a single evidence.
No.
How pathetic is that? Let me ask you one question.
In ancient antiquity, what do you accept to be an historical fact?
I just told you.
You didn't.
What did I say?
Give me one. Just give me one historical fact.
I just told you.
No, you haven't. Tell me then. I didn't hear it.
You didn't hear what? Any court of law, reasonable, sane judge will accept as evidence. I will accept as evidence.
Is he answering my question?
I just told you.
Is he answering my question?
What was the question again?
Tell me one historical fact that he accepts in ancient antiquity.
Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he existed.
No.
We have documentary. I'm telling
antiquity.
You now.
Antiquity.
Oh, so 1400 years is not antiquity?
No, it's not. You know that's not considered antiquity.
Hang on.
Ancient antiquity.
Hang on. So if I now find the very embalmed corpse of an individual inscribed all over him, Tutankhamun, or whatever, right? These people who are dead, and they were, what do you call it? Mummified. I would accept that as a material evidence that this guy existed. And this guy is known to be this. Material evidence. This could be accepted in any court of law. So I ask you again now.
No, you didn't answer my question.
Provide me with a single piece of evidence that Christ was crucified.
Not answer my question. You know you didn't.
What did I just tell you?
You didn't answer my
question. I accept Tutankhamun. He existed.
No, no, I'm talking about...
And I have material evidence.
I'm talking about ancient antiquity.
Oh, it's not ancient antiquity. Oh, the pharaohs and the mummies are not ancient antiquity.
In Greco-Roman culture.
So you want to now pin me towards and direct me to Greco-Roman culture and say, and this is what happened? No, I'm not going to do that.
Okay, then there's no point in having this.
There's no point in talking to you because you're not being fair.
No, no, you're not being
because
fair.
Because you are the one who made a claim Christ crucified.
I can give you many evidence, but every single evidence you're going to be
saying, well, what evidence did you share?
There's a Shroud of Turin.
Shroud of Turin provides what? Evidence that he died?
Well, evidence that, he was crucified, definitely he died,
The Shroud of Turin, seriously.
Have you looked into the evidence of Shroud of Turin? Have you?
Have you?
Have you?
Yes, a little bit. Have you?
Okay, yes, I have,
Okay.
I think it's quite compelling,
Okay, what is the evidence from the Shroud of Turin?
I believe that, I know obviously the objections.
I'm not asking more objections. What is the evidence? That it's indeed evidence that Christ was crucified.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Christ, not someone else.
It was the burial cloth of Christ, yeah.
And what was it found? Was it found in his tomb?
No, it wasn't found in his tomb.
So why do you consider it was his body that was wrapped up?
Because... Because chain of transmission, the Catholic Church.
I'm not interested in Catholic Church.
But you're talking about change of transmission. Hang on.
Catholic Church.
You are being inconsistent. Look, one minute you want change of transmission. Oh. I'll give you the Catholic.
Okay.
Church.
Name them.
Change of transmission.
Name the people and the name.
I can get it for you. I can get it for you.
So basically, now you have a chain of individuals within the Catholic Church.
Made the claim that this was Jesus' burial place.
All the way back to.
Yes.
Back to when?
Back to Peter.
All the way, they link it back to Peter.
All the way, yes, they do.
So you have Peter who informed his students and so on,
Peter, Linus, Cletus, Clement of Rome.
And every single individual was testified to be honest.
I'm just saying they've got a chain of narration, that's all I'm saying.
But my criteria is not just chain of narration.
Okay, then what can
my criteria are any witness that you bring.
Brother, I'm giving you a cumulative
You're not listening, are you? The standard of evidence I demand is this.
Exactly so.
Character integrity.
This guy's epistemology.
Listen, I've just told you my epistemology. Character integrity. Character integrity. How many times have I made this point? Any person that you bring within the chain of narrations, you have to establish character integrity.
It's being inconsistent because even if I apply the same basis...
So you are going to bring, William...
Muhammad...
You are going to bring a chain of transmission of the Shroud of Turin that every single individual has been testified of their character integrity.
I never said that, did I?
But that was my standard.
Can you take the chain of narration from anyone? Can you take the narration from anyone?
I'm just talking, the Catholic Church have their own tradition. Eastern Orthodox have their tradition. And they all have chains of narrations that go back to the early apostles.
And they have
all
character integrity testified.
Even the Coptic Church. So,
William, every single individual in the chain of transmission,
Christians don't use this as our basis.
Their character.
To say that, the Coptic Church,
William,
Eastern Orthodox,
William,
Catholics
okay,
have a chain
you
of
know
transmission.
What?
Just
to summarize, right?
Do you hear my point? But
if within the chain of transmitter.
So anyway, next week, what do you want me to bring to
William,
you?
William, listen.
No, because I'm getting tired and we're not getting anywhere.
No, you're making yourself tired for a reason. I'll tell you why.
No.
Within the chain of the narration of the Shroud of Turin, if you find within this chain one individual was known and certified to be a liar, would you accept that transmission of information? Would you?
Can I say one thing?
Answer that question.
I personally...
Would you accept it?
Let me explain.
Explain, but answer that question.
You're not answering.
Would you accept a liar within the chain of transmission?
Listen to my point.
Would you?
I personally, you would never hear me argue to affirm any Christian doctrine or any Christian belief based on the Eastern, Catholic, Coptic...
Because you can't.
No, I don't. I wouldn't.
Because you can't. No, you wouldn't.
They have it. They have it. It's there.
You can't.
Okay.
So what I'm asking you right now.
Don't say I can't.
Look, what I said right now is this: if you find within the chain of the transmission within the Catholic Church about the Shroud of Turin, there was an individual. Suppose you established that there was an individual known to be a liar. Would you accept this testimony?
No. The point I'm trying to make is.
Is that a no, as in I would not?
You're not listening to my.
Hang on. Is that a no, as in I would not accept the testimony?
Listen. You're not listening to my. No.
Can you answer the question? If you find a person who is a liar, certified liar, testified by the community that he's a liar, dishonest.
I never argued.
Would you? No, listen to my argument. My argument is the standard of evidence I'm laying to you. So now, would you accept that testimony from that individual? Would you?
Well, just because they lie doesn't mean...
Would you accept...
I'm just telling you, I'm accepting. Just because maybe you lied on one thing doesn't mean I'm going to say that you lied on one thing.
So, yeah. So you would accept his testimony even though he was a certified liar?
If he was what, sorry?
A certified liar.
If he was a compulsive liar, then...
Certified liar!
That's the same thing.
No, not necessarily.
No, no, no. A compulsive liar. There's a difference.
I know people who lie.
Certified liar.
I know people who lie.
The community have agreed together that this individual is a liar.
You know people.
They certified
it. I'm sure you've lied before. I'm sure you know.
No, certified liar.
Certified liar.
Well,
if somebody's a compulsive liar, no, then I don't.
No.
Certified liar.
No, certified. You mean compulsive liar?
No, I don't mean compulsive liar.
Somebody who's lied once. Is that what you
mean? No, I mean the community testified that this guy is a liar.
Well, then that would speak volumes, wouldn't it? Yeah.
Would you accept his testimony?
No, I wouldn't, no.
Right. So it's important then, in any chain that you bring, you have to establish the character integrity. That's the point I was making.
This is the problem. This is
so now, no, do no, you no, have no. a chain in which every single member...
This is the problem.
Can
no,
I finish
no,
my
no,
point?
No, no, no. Let me
can I finish
point.
My point, no, William?
It's
if, remember what you said, the Shroud of Turin, we have the Catholic Church with the continuous chain of narrations, let me finish, all the way back to Peter, who witnessed it. So now, the two standards that have to be met...
John
to John, okay.
John, yeah.
He said Peter, actually. The Shroud of Turin. So if you now find the standards that we're demanding to accept as evidence, one is contemporaneity, or if not...
Listen,
I have not finished. Can
James
I finish?
The above of Jesus.
Listen,
Jude above of Jesus.
William.
Peter the disciple.
William, listen.
John the disciple.
It will help you understand,
and you
right?
all of it.
So I have not rejected, I have dismissed them. And I'll tell you why I dismissed them. I'm telling you straight away. So as I have been asking so far, if you have no contemporary manuscript evidence, then we look for oral continuity. Can I finish? Thank you very much. We look for oral traditions, continuous information by memory to memory, mouth to mouth, oral. Memorization could be at the chain. Do you have that? You said yes. We have a chain of transmissions of the Catholic Church. The other standard that's being met, if you have a chain of transmission like this, are the witnesses, the narrators, persons of highest character? Let me finish.
No, please, Baba.
Character integrity. So now, do you have the character integrity established in the chain of narration of the Catholic Church?
His worldview believes that Jesus' followers were Muslims. God-fearing people.
Do you see
so
the point?
Dismissing
instead
the followers of Jesus,
arguing his case and providing evidence, he's going to go
he's throwing the
to
Quran
deflection.
Under the bus.
No, deflection.
I'm just saying he's being inconsistent.
You've been
because
deflecting.
The Quran
throughout
says that Jesus' followers were Muslims. They followed Allah's will. And now I give him all the disciples. Oh, maybe they're not honest.
Hang on.
Do you
have a testimony of the people of each other that they were honest?
It refutes your Quran.
Hang on.
Does your not Quran say that Jesus' disciples were Muslims? Yes,
which ones were they?
No, it doesn't say.
Hang on, which ones were they?
It doesn't mention their names.
No, which ones
but
were
even
they?
Even in your...
Hang on. The people who were the disciples of Christ, were they not ordinary fishermen?
Not all of them, no. That's wrong.
Hang on.
You're wrong.
Who were they?
Who were they?
Yeah.
Well, you just said all of them were ordinary fishermen. You're wrong.
No, so you're saying they were not?
Some of them were.
And some of them were what? Educated?
Yeah, of course.
And they followed him?
Why not? Why are you incredible?
Wait. So you have now...
A tax collector working
right,
for...
I've got to move about, yeah.
Tax collector working for the Roman Empire would have been proficient in Greek.
And he was...
You accept that, right?
Hang on. And he was with Christ?
You would accept that, right?
Listen. Was he with Christ?
Of course he was.
How long?
What do you mean, how long? Jesus' ministry spanned about 3 years.
3 years. How long was he with him?
3 years, I suppose.
So... Did this tax collector, who you call Matthew, is that what you call him?
Yeah.
Right, what's his second name?
Well, his other name was Levi. But see, this is where you're wrong. No, let me just explain one
Am
thing.
Am I asking you something unreasonable?
No, it is unreasonable.
Because what's his second name?
Because in the first century,
he doesn't have a second name.
Israel did not have second names.
What do they have?
They didn't. They had other names.
Like?
So
like what?
If you read,
like
so
what?
For example,
like what?
Peter was called Cephas. Yeah.
And what was Matthew called?
Matthew was called Levi.
So yeah. People knew him as Matthew the Levite.
So, no, what I'm saying is, so they had some people had different names, like Paul and Saul had two different names. Jesus only had one name. So even Jesus, no. So what's Jesus' second name?
I'm asking you. Which
he didn't have one. That's what I'm saying. My point is.
So wait. So his name. So his name was only
Jesus. Yeah. Jesus. That's why he was called Jesus.
Wait.
Of Nazareth.
So his name was only Jesus.
They didn't have second names. Come on.
I'm asking you.
Somebody as intelligent as you.
I'm God. Slow down. So he was only known as Jesus. Or Isa or Yeshua.
Yeshua of Nazareth. Yeah.
Oh, Yeshua of Nazareth.
Yeah.
So also they had something to identify. To connect.
Why is that? Mary Magdalene. Mary from
because
Magdala.
Because there were many other Jesuses.
Thank you.
Right. Yes. So now Matthew.
So do you agree?
Wait.
Asking for a second name is folly.
No.
That means second you don't know
name.
You don't
second
know
name could be an identifier of his kunya.
Of his history.
I'm just telling you, something to identify who
you're
this person
something
is.
That they that wasn't there historically, so that's a street.
So basically, every person of that time did have a second name.
No, of course not. You might find in the Bible his surname was. But the surname is not as we know it. Mm. Surname means other name.
Right.
So sometimes.
So now we find you have the disciples who was with him and they witnessed his crucifixion and they wrote about him. And so far we have no evidence from them.
I've given you John, you didn't accept it.
You've given me John and you have no given me contemporary extant evidence from him. Neither did you provide any character, character certificate that he was an honest person.
Let me ask you something. If we found a first century manuscript of John, would you believe Jesus died on the cross?
If we find a first century manuscript of John, and it says Jesus died on the cross, that will only establish the author believed that Christ died on the cross.
So would you accept Jesus died on the cross?
Did you hear what I said?
No, I'm asking you.
Did you hear what I said?
So that means you're
did you hear what I said?
So my point is, the reason why I ask you that, is your point to say that we have no extant manuscript.
What was my response?
No, so
hang on. What was my response?
You would say that he believed that.
Right. Is that unreasonable?
So my point is...
No. Is my stance unreasonable?
Yes.
Why?
Because when I said to you about John, you said because we don't have no contemporaneous...
I even gave you... Even if you find a John's gospel... Look, even if you find... John...
We have no...
You're not listening. Even if
listening.
If you find John...
So
with all this...
That as your argument then. That's my point.
Let me establish my argument. Do you know there are many hieroglyphic writings
which talks... Well, let's talk about this next week.
No, I've got to go.
Seriously.
Okay, we're going to finish this in 1 minute then. Yeah. Hieroglyphic writings talks about God of the underworld and God of the overworld. When they write about these things, because they write about it, it means it's true, right? According to your epistemology?
No, but if they were willing... Now listen, wait.
So you're saying just because they write it, it doesn't mean it's true.
They were willing to die for what they knew to be true or false.
And if those writers in hieroglyphics, they're willing to die for
so
their
you
belief.
Need to understand. What
can I make a point? Yeah.
To die for something that you knew was either true
if,
or false.
If a writer, like in the hieroglyphics, writes something and they're willing to die for their belief, does it make it true?
Oh, it will make me believe that they honestly believed it to be true.
Does it make it true in reality that what they talk about the God of the underworld is true?
No, well, so say that again, what was the question? No, because what we're talking about is an historical event. They were willing...
When they're right...
No, let me finish, Bob. Let me finish. They're willing to die for a historical event.
No,
it's totally different.
That's
not based on a philosophy. Totally
so
different.
When the hieroglyphics were written...
Forget about that.
When,
I'm talking
no,
about
no, no,
the
no, forget about it. When we understand antiquity and the text of antiquity, when people write about things
Listen.
In antiquity, if we are finding the hieroglyphics, people are writing God of the underworld and God of the overworld, does it not establish...
You're missing the point.
Let me make my point. I haven't made my point. My point is, the stance is, what we understand from this writing is, the author, the scribe who wrote it, it was their belief that there was a God of the overworld, God of the underworld. It is not reflective of the truth. So if you find John or Matthew or Mark, whoever writes it, it is only reflective of their belief that there was someone X, Y, and Z who did X, Y, and Z. It doesn't mean it's true. So, to provide evidence that Christ was crucified and dead, do you find someone saying, okay, I witnessed with my own eyes and I checked his pulse and he was dead, and this kind of evidence is acceptable? You have none of that.
Brother, you honestly think first century Jews didn't know what a dead man looked like, no? Come on, man. No, you're,
hang on. Wait a second. Are you saying today there are not many people who are in a coma and people mistake them as dead?
In a coma.
Yeah, and mistaken as dead. There are many people out there. The people mistake them as dead.
Where did you get that from?
I work in a hospital, my friend. Right? So I'm not getting it from anywhere. Somebody, I'm not pulling it from thin air.
Somebody in a coma, nobody thinks they're dead. They're obviously in a coma.
If people saw that he was there, just sitting there, motionless, people might think he's dead. But only when you look at beep, 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 they will say, oh, heart is beating. Did people go and check his heart, pulse? Do you have any record anyone checked his pulse?
One moment.
Please answer. Blatantly. Clearly, categorically.
Next week, maybe
in a few years' time. Do you find anyone checking his pulse? Oh, is he dead? There is no such evidence. So the summary of our discussion is, we have a Christian friend, individual, who thought he believes in the Bible because Bible is true. And the basis of his truth is archaeological evidence. And when you find what is the archaeological evidence, provide with some, every single evidence that he's bringing is not an evidence, can be dismissed as belief of certain people, rumors of certain people. That doesn't provide any evidence whatsoever. So now we realize that, you know, people need to up their standards of evidence when they talk about their belief. Otherwise, it's simply a matter of blind faith. Just because you find a writing here and there, it doesn't make it true. If that was the case, why don't you accept so many narrations from Prophet Muhammad ﷺ's companions, talking about his miracles, talking about his prophethood? Why didn't you do that? You should accept him as a prophet of God.